Welcome back to this next video, and in this video we are going to talk about the non-receptor tyrosine kinase mediated cell signaling. In the last video we talked about the fibroblast growth factor, and in the fibroblast growth factor we discussed that the fibroblast growth factor receptor, it has got an intracellular domain which is known as the tyrosine kinase. Now in this particular video, we are going to talk about the non-receptor tyrosine kinases. So the first thing you need to understand is what is a tyrosine kinase. Now the tyrosine kinases, these are the enzymes that are responsible for transferring a phosphate group from a nucleoside triphosphate donor, for example like the ATP, to the tyrosine residues in the target protein. So these are known as the tyrosine kinases, and they are making a very small group of the kinases that are there in the living system. Now these tyrosine kinases, if you talk about the human beings for example, they are broadly divided into two types. One, they are known as the receptor tyrosine kinases, and the other one, they are known as the non-receptor tyrosine kinases. So the first thing you have to do is to differentiate between these two kind of the tyrosine kinases. Now the basic thing that remain the same in these two classes, that is both of them, they are the tyrosine kinases, whether that is a receptor tyrosine kinase or that is a non-receptor tyrosine kinase. Both have the capability to attach a phosphate group at the tyrosine amino acid in its target protein. So the difference is, if you look at this particular receptor, as we discussed in the last video, that these transmembrane receptor have three domains. One is known as the extracellular domain, which is present outside the cell. One is known as the transmembrane domain, which is present inside the cell membrane. And then you have got an intracellular domain, which is known as the intracellular domain. Now, if you talk about the receptor tyrosine kinases, in this particular case, the tyrosine kinase is an integral part of the receptor. Therefore, we call them as the receptor tyrosine kinases. When you talk about the non-receptor tyrosine kinases, we are actually talking about the cytosolic enzymes. They are not part of any receptor, and they are there free in the cytoplasm. Therefore, we call them as the non-receptor tyrosine kinase. And this non-receptor here means that they are not integral part of the receptor, but they are there in the cytoplasm. So they are the cytosolic kinases. But again, the function remains the same. Both are tyrosine kinases, and they are going to attach a phosphate group to its target protein at the tyrosine residues. Now, one of the famous examples for the non-receptor tyrosine kinase is the SRC protein kinase, which is actually the Rous Sarcoma virus protein kinase. That is one of the typical examples of the non-receptor tyrosine kinases. This protein, the SRC protein, that in human is coded by a gene that is known as the SRC gene, and in the human this is called is the c-SRC, that is the cellular SRC, or you can call it is the cellular SARC, as compared to the v-SRC in the Rous sarcoma virus. So if you talk about the viral version of the SRC protein, that is known as the v-SRC. We talk about the human version, that is known as the c-SRC. So that is the difference between the viral and the human version of the SRC protein. The normal function of the SRC protein is to regulate the proliferation and the differentiation. If you look at the SRC protein, it have got different domains. In each of the domain, they have got their specific function. The first domain is known as the N-terminal domain. And this N-terminal domain, it actually have one or more acylation sites, and the function of these acylation site is to anchor the protein to the cell membrane. So if you talk about the SRC protein, that is actually a membrane attached protein, and the N-terminal domain is actually helping attaching the SRC protein to the cell membrane. This is how an acyl group looks like. The other domain that is present in the SRC protein, that is known as the SH3 domain, and the function of the SH3 domain is to bind to the proline-rich peptides in the target proteins. The third domain that is there, that is known as the SH2 domain, and the function of the SH2 domain is to bind to phosphorylated tyrosine residues in the target protein. Now, the C-terminal regulatory domain is actually, as the name indicates, is responsible for the regulation of the activity of the SRC kinase. And we will see that in a while, how the C-terminal is responsible for regulation of the activity of this protein. And the last one that is known is the tyrosine kinase domain. And as the name indicates, this is the domain that is responsible for attaching a phosphate group to the tyrosine amino acids in the target protein. This is a diagrammatic representation of the SRC protein. You have got this meristoylation site, which is actually the N-terminal domain, and this is responsible for attaching it to the cell membrane. You have got this SH3 domain, the SH2 domain, and then you have got the kinase domain, and in the end, you have got the C-terminal domain. Now, how the SRC signaling mechanisms work? Now, if the activity of the SRC protein is not required, it is actually the activity of the C-terminal domain to shut down the activity of the SRC protein. Now, how this phenomena of shutting down the SRC protein is achieved? Now, there is a particular kinase in the cell, which is known as the CSK kinase, which is the C-terminal SRC kinase. Now, as the name indicates, we are again talking about a kinase, and this is another tyrosine kinase. Now, what this kinase do is it is going to phosphorylate a tyrosine at position number 527 at the C-terminal of the SRC protein, and when the CSK, it phosphorylates the 527 tyrosine at the C-terminal, this phosphorylated tyrosine 527, when it is phosphorylated, it is going to bind to the SH2 domain of the SRC protein, of the same protein. If this is the whole SRC protein, when the C-terminal is phosphorylated by the CSK kinase, this phosphorylated tyrosine is going to bind to the SH2 domain of this SRC protein. Now, when the SH2 domain, as I've told you, it is responsible for binding to the phosphorylated tyrosine, and when it binds to its own phosphorylated tyrosine, this is going to shut down the SRC protein, because this SH2 domain, if it is occupied by the tyrosine of this same protein, it will not be able to interact with other signaling protein, and hence the activity of the SRC protein that will be shut down. Now, this interaction of the SH2 domain to its own tyrosine 527, that is going to render the SH2 domain of the SRC incapable of binding to phosphorylated tyrosines from a stimulatory factor. So in this particular case, the activity of the SRC protein that will be shut down. Now, this is a diagrammatic representation. When the SRC protein that is active, you can see its SH2 domain that is free to interact with stimulatory factors, and the kinase domain that can actually phosphorylate its target protein. But when the activity is not required, the C-terminal 527, it is going to bind to this SH2 domain, thereby making a closed structure of the SRC protein, and in this particular structure, the SRC cannot perform its activity. Now, when the activity of the SRC protein that is required, so the first problem in the activation, that is the phosphorylation at the 527. So the first step is there is a phosphatase in the cell. That phosphatase, its function is opposite to that of the kinase. The kinases are going to add a phosphate group. The phosphatases are going to remove a phosphate group. So when the phosphatase, it's act on the tyrosine 527, which was phosphorylated by the CSK kinase, the phosphatase is going to remove this phosphate group, and when the phosphate group from this tyrosine 527 that is removed, this tyrosine will not be able to interact with the SH2 domain because the SH2 domain only interact with the phosphorylated tyrosine. And now this tyrosine has been dephosphorylated by the phosphatase. The SH2 is not going to interact with this tyrosine 527, and this SH2 is now free to interact with the stimulatory factor from the signals. So the presence of this SH2 domain, it will have the ability to bind to the phosphorylated tyrosine to the other proteins, thereby activating the SRC protein. Now the SRC protein, it performs a lot of functions. In this particular video, I'm only going to focus on two things: how the SRC protein is responsible for stimulating the cell division, and how it is responsible for the migration or the cell adhesion using the focal adhesion kinase. Now in this particular case, if you see, if there is a growth factor, for example, this is, there is the epidermal growth factor, there is the platelet-derived growth factor. So when the platelet-derived growth factor, for example, that binds to its receptor, the intracellular domain, they are going to phosphorylate each other, and when they are phosphorylated, that means there will be a phosphorylated tyrosine present on the intracellular domain of this receptor. The SRC will utilize its SH2 domain to bind to these phosphorylated tyrosines, and when the SRC do so, that is going to activate the MAPK signaling pathway. And at the end of the MAPK signaling pathway, the cyclins and the CDKs of the G1 protein, that will be activated, and that is going to lead to the cell division. Now how these fibroblast growth factor or the other kind of the growth factors, that actually work utilizing the phosphorylated tyrosine, I have a detailed video on that, and I'll share the link in the description, how the phosphorylated tyrosine at the intracellular domain of the receptor is responsible for activation of the cyclin in the CDKs, and hence the cell division. Another important function of the SRC protein is the activation of this particular protein, which is known as the focal adhesion kinase. How this works, that will be clear in the next slide. Now the focal adhesion kinase, how this actually works, there are different kind of the proteins in the extracellular matrix. The important one, they are the fibronectin, which is a glycoprotein having a molecular weight nearly 440 kilodaltons. There is another protein which is known as the vitronectin, and that is an abundant glycoprotein found in the serum and in the extracellular matrix. Now both of these proteins, the fibronectin and the vitronectin, they have the ability to bind to a particular receptor which are known as the integrin receptors. And this integrin receptor, that is made up of two subunits. One is known as the alpha subunit, and the other one, that is known as the beta subunit. So when the fibronectin or the vitronectin, they interact with this integrin receptor, the alpha and the beta subunit, they are going to come close to each other. And when they come close to each other, they're actually providing the binding sites for different proteins like the paxillin and the talin to the intracellular domain of this particular receptor. So this one is the extracellular matrix. Here we are actually talking about the interior of the cell and about the intracellular part of the cell. So when the fibronectin or the vitronectin, they bind these integrin proteins, they are going to provide binding site for the paxillin and the talin. Now the talin, the paxillin, and another protein which is known as the focal adhesion kinase, when they make this particular structure, this is known as the focal adhesion contact. Now this focal adhesion contact, when you see, that actually needs the SRC protein for its activation. So the SRC, that is actually responsible for the activation of this focal adhesion kinase. And what these focal adhesion kinase do, or what this focal adhesion contact do, that they are responsible for making the actin stress fibers. Now what are these actin stress fibers? These actin stress fibers are usually composed of 10 to 30 actin filaments, and they play a very important role in the cellular contractility. They provide force for a number of functions like the cell adhesion, the migration, and the morphogenesis. So if you look at this one, the SRC on one side is responsible for causing the responsible for the cell division. On the other hand, that is actually responsible in activation of the focal adhesion kinase and hence in the formation of the actin stress fiber, providing a number of functions like the cell adhesion, the migration, and the morphogenesis. So one of the important thing to keep in mind is that these integrins, when they bind to the extracellular proteins, they actually bind via the short amino acid sequences. For example, there is a short amino acid sequence like the arginine, glycine, aspartate, that is a sequence motif that is found in the fibronectin and the vitronectin that we just discussed. So the fibronectin and the vitronectin, they are going to utilize this particular sequence to interact with the integrin protein. Or there is another sequence which is known, which is the aspartate, glycine, glutamate, alanine, or the glycine, phenylalanine, glycine, glutamate, or arginine motifs, and they are actually found in the collagen protein. So the collagen protein will be utilizing these kind of the amino acid motifs to interact with the integrin proteins, thereby causing a variety of the cellular functions. So if you like the video, please subscribe to my channel, like the video, and share this video with your friends. It might be helpful. We will continue this in the next video.